Howdy, y'all. Pastor Josh here. Took the week off last week. I was out of town, but it is good to be back in the saddle here. It is my birthday week, and so because it's my birthday week, it's a jersey week, and so I'm wearing jerseys this week. Some of my favorite players from my childhood and adolescence. So Monday was Ken Griffey Jr., and yesterday was Nolan Ryan, and today is Jose Lima, who pitched for the Houston Astros and who we lost a few years ago, unfortunately. So he's always a character and a fun guy to hear him give an interview and joke around, and also a salsa musician. So you've got that going for you too. So it's always fun to have some fun with some of those things when we can. What I want to do today for our devotion is look at Isaiah chapter 6. So if you want to pull that up, if you want to pause it real quick to pull that up or to grab a Bible or that sort of thing, you can. I'm going to read Isaiah 6 starting about the first half of this chapter, starting with verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, Isaiah speaking, "Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips, your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for." This is God's word. So, have you ever thought about what you would say when you stand before the throne of God for the first time? And probably most of us would put us in the category of Isaiah and say something like, "Woe is me." And we would feel standing before the Lord in that way, in glory. We would feel unworthy. We would feel inadequate. And in feeling that, what you're feeling is just the chasm that exists between God and us, that exists between creator and creation. And not only are we creation, creatures, just means a created being, not only are we creatures, but we are sinners. We have rebelled against the one who made us and the one to whom we owe all honor, all allegiance. We can't stand before him. We cannot stand on our own two feet as people who deserve anything other than his righteous wrath and judgment. And so, in that moment, before God himself, however much woe we own, it would be completely wrong to even focus on ourselves, right? There's a subject and there's an object. In the immediate presence of God Almighty, we would lift up our eyes beyond our own inadequacy and failings, and what we would see is his glory, and what we would declare is his praise. And as we opened up our mouths to speak, what would we say in that setting? And I think human language would fail us, right? What do you say in finite human words when you're standing before an infinite God of the Bible, creator of the world, of the universe? Could any word or statement do in that kind of moment? Will not any language we reach for prove trivial and inadequate? We might not even be able to muster a word and just be there in awe and in silence and feel that inadequacy before him. However, in the presence of God, there is one word that becomes a phrase that we do and can have something to say, and then say again, and then say again, and that is holy, holy, holy. And so we see it here in Isaiah. He gets this vision of glory, and he sees God in heaven seated on the throne, and there are these six-winged celestial creatures called seraphim. Think about them as angels, but they cry out to one another in the presence of God, and they say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And so before the prophet Isaiah felt the weight and felt the tarnish of his own sin and declared woe upon himself, he first heard and was caught up into angelic praise in heaven. Not just holy, but holy, holy, holy. Now, this is neat because as you keep reading your Bible, you get into the New Testament and the Apostle John writes centuries later. He got a vision of heaven and he saw heaven in glory. And it tells us in Revelation 4, that he saw four living creatures, each of them with six wings. Sounds familiar. And day and night they never ceased to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and who is to come." Their prayer is a little bit different, but that key aspect is there with holy, holy, holy. So God has given us a word that is fit for declaring his praise when all other language fails us. And so we often praise the Lord in ways that we can understand, borrowed from our finite brains, our limited experience and understanding. We do things like sing songs that other people have written. We quote the Bible often in our worship songs and our hymns and our praise songs. And in doing so, we cry out and we praise his strength and his love and his justice and his mercy. And we also realize that God's value and worth doesn't even fill up the human categories that we can come up with, but instead it far surpasses them. And he's even more strong than we know. And he's even more loving than we know. And he's even more just than we know. And he's even more merciful than we know. And in those moments, when we sense that we have exhausted the comparisons that we can make to our world and to our experience, we have a word that we can use. And that word is holy. And it points to his uniqueness, the fact that God is in a class by himself. He is set apart from us. He is higher. He is more glorious than us. And so we cry out, holy. And when we get a glimpse of his infinite intrinsic value and wonder in worship, who else is like this? The answer is no one. And so we cry out in worship, holy, holy, holy. No one else wields that kind of authority. No one else has authority over God. No one else commands the hosts of heaven. And that word host, that's an army word. The armies of heaven, the angel armies, we say sometimes. Okay? No one else makes kings, and not just some kings, but one day all of the kings, to bow down. And no one else can make darkness itself tremble with a whisper. There's no other glory like his. And no one deserves that kind of praise. No one else's splendor outshines the sun. Think about that. There's no other beauty, no other power, no other name that is like his. And what more can we say than holy, holy, holy? So, in the face of so much authority and such glory and such power, do we not cower? Right? How can we hear his summons and come with anything other than dread? Why do we not flee, as futile as it would be, from such majesty when we know we are deserving of woe? And it's because the holy God of the universe is not only awesome in authority and in power, but also in grace and mercy. Who else is like him? Who else is holy? Who else, as the capstone of his glory, rescues sinners like us from our failings? Who else demonstrates his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us? Right? This holy God who we've been talking about today, he sent his own son for us and he offered him up for our sins and he raised him from the dead. He seated him at the right hand, and now through faith in him, God extends to us all the rights and privileges of divine sonship. And it's the holy God who does that. And so we cry out, holy, holy, holy. Hope you guys are having a great week. We do have worship on Sunday with Holy Communion. Do want to continue to remind everybody that we do want to take those safety precautions as we've been given those by our leaders. We want to make sure that we're following them. We probably all have places where we slacked off a little bit, and we want to make sure that we're doing the things that we are supposed to do. So if you do come to church, we do ask that you wear a mask. That's one of the guidance rules that we've been given these days. And as well, if you are still uncomfortable coming back to worship, being, you know, in a place with a lot of people. We totally understand that. We're still working on beefing up our online items and offerings for you, so we'll continue to work on that. And as well, if you are in one of the higher risk groups, we would continue to ask you to do the same. Please take care of yourself, and we will take care of you as best we can with these online features and all the rest of it. So good to see you guys. Follow me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, follow me on Instagram. Don't follow me in real life. Subscribe if you haven't subscribed. Ring the bell. Stay frosty, and we'll see you in, man, I need to get a haircut. Anyway, that's coming. We'll see you in the next one. Bye.